is the disruptive technology. And for me, I have new technology all my life. What I worry more is how technology changes life in ways which we don't even imagine when it comes up. So to give you a perspective, technology is the only change that happens and the life surrounds it, the society actually falls around it. Many of us don't kind of understand it intuitively, but for example, what Mr. Goenka talked about of giving services, the government services to people, would not be possible if we didn't have the new technology. And so slowly, when we talk about corruption, because the last election, in my opinion, was fought on three planks. One is corruption, second is employment, and third is inflation. Inflation is getting resolved, but it may come up any time. The corruption part has two aspects to it. One is what I call procedural corruption. Other is what I call policy corruption. Procedural corruption is where you go to stand in the ration queue and before your number comes, the shutter comes down and the person says that the week is over. I have faced that in life before. And so you always think the guys are corrupt, they have sold the wheat which was available to you in the market somewhere. And that is procedural corruption. Procedural corruption is easy to handle by automating. And that's happening in land registration, flat registration, rent stuff and so on. So you have seen some of the government services getting automated. Over the next 5, 10, 20 years, you will see many more getting kind of automated. And so procedural corruption, once you bring transparency, once you bring SLAs and other stuff, it becomes easier to manage. The policy corruption is where you give up the country's resources, natural resources, at zero cost, for example, coal. In fact, day before yesterday, rather on Saturday, I was with Honorable Finance Minister who was here, and he mentioned that even I was skeptical about Renewable Rice numbers, and he said now he's being proven so right. So effectively, the policy corruption is basically getting resolved by getting newer frameworks of options and stuff like that. Why I'm giving you this perspective is, if technology was not there to manage all this, probably it would not have still happened. The RTI would not have been so effective and so on and so forth. But more importantly, one single piece of technology, what we now know as information technology, has changed life fundamentally and transformationally over the last 30 years. Last 30 years have seen life change, the wealth created, more than over the last 10,000 years. And so, technology has that much more power. Earlier, new technologies used to come, say steam engine or canals. They would take long time to get into human life. It would take 100 years, 200 years. Even television, which came up in 1950s, it took almost 50, 60 years to reach out to everyone. But slowly, that cycle of spreading out technology is becoming shorter and shorter. It's reaching out to your house, to your home, to your hands, to your families much, much faster. And that is also reducing the time of spreading that. And it's basically, there is a plateau that comes up very fast. For example, when I was like 10 years back, I used to work for a telecom company. And we used to discuss how do you increase the tele density of India, which was 4 out of 100. So every 4 Indians had access to 4 out of 100 people. And digging up roads going to the last mile used to be a problem. One new technology of mobile, with prices coming down, it suddenly changed the India in a completely different way. And today, we have 90 phones out of 100 or probably 100 phones out of 100. And that is basically, again, about disruption, which happens completely and thoroughly. And it happens much shorter time frame. In 10 years, India has changed. Before that, I mean, GDP is my kind of take much time because I have too much to talk and too little time. But effectively, the previous technologies were taking longer time, the newer technologies are taking shorter time. Second hypothesis I have is that numerous technologies are now moving at the same time. It's not one technology, but several of them are now, it's like a balloon, you know, you put in more air, it becomes larger on all sides. And so more and more technologies are coming to our lives. And many of them will change life fundamentally. I will recount some of them, but I have this fundamental belief that last 30 years have created huge wealth, have changed life fundamentally, transformationally. But next 30 years will make previous 30 years look like a trailer. The amount of wealth that is going to be created is going to be phenomenal. And India will have a huge role to play because of the youth that India has. More than 50% of Indians are below age 25. And youth can learn. Old people cannot learn. And newer technologies, you might have seen your child or your grandchild taking up a mobile, even if they are 1 year old, 2 year old, and playing with technology as if they were born with it, which they did. And we still find it very, very troublesome, exploring a feature of a mobile phone or so on and so forth. So effectively, youth can learn. And India, uniquely without design by government, by anyone, has become very scientifically oriented, technologically oriented. Over last 30 years, we have created a situation, or the world has created a situation where India has become successful in technology, especially information technology. And that has, in a sense, promoted a framework where every youngster wants to make money or become a billionaire like Nandan Nilekani or Narayan Murthy or Arvind Premji or whoever by using technology. And that is a great, great thing that is happening to India. And for me, that is going to change India much more than the rest of the world, because Japan is old. China is suddenly getting old. China will have less number of people coming into the job market in 2017 than in 2016. It's creating a wage pressure on daily wages, which is going to be phenomenal. In the last 35 years, from 1979 to 2014, China has a phenomenal growth because of the youth power. Next 35 years, India will have youth power. And that is going to be very, very different. And China had gone into what I call manual labor activities. We have, by default, not by design, we have gone into high-tech areas, more brainy areas. And so, somewhere on the line, we seem to be a society which can become rich before we become old. China has suddenly become old, and they have not even become rich. So somewhere, there is a lot of hope. And some of the disruptive IT technologies, I think Deepak talked about big data, cloud, mobile, social network. For me, each technology comes up and then it plateaus. And these are not even technologies. IT is a much larger piece in which all these are coming up. And 20 years, it has transformationally changed life. But like electricity, when it was invented, anyone would have thought that you will be actually watching TV out of it? Or having mixer, or having even clothes being washed using electricity. IT is going to be much more fundamentally changing over the next 20, 30, 50 years. But whatever had to be visioned, whatever had to be envisioned, has been envisioned. It will still have some incremental stuff. But for a society, we have already reaped most of the rewards. It plateaus. So 20 years, we went into software development as a country. And then last 10 years, we are trying to go into BPO because the software development plateaued. And so we had to get one more acceleration and went into the BPO side. And now we need to find some more acceleration or some more industries which can change India. Otherwise, what we are selling is our manpower. What we are selling is our brain power. And rest of the world, if they are able to buy, why would they buy? Because we are numerous. And so we need to create newer and newer frameworks to come into that. Some of our leaders, especially business leaders, some sitting here, some of you are doing that. But for me, more interesting stuff, which doesn't get talked about, the Internet of Things. Internet of Things is going to change, again, life fundamentally, but it's still, for me, part of IT. And Internet of Things is like electricity getting into the microphones, electricity getting into lightings, electricity getting into washing your clothes and so on and so forth. So Internet of Things is going to be one more large fundamental change where all of you have worked in, you have some familiarity, get involved, it's going to be a new deluge. These 100 smart cities is going to be made feasible out of Internet of Things. and be aware that you have a legitimate role to play in that. The big data will be used in things which we have not even thought about. There are many things which you use when you use Facebook, when you use Twitter, when you use many things, including colors in the background on this, are now being done using the big data by giving you different choices, checking out what are your views. In fact, the BJP in next election would certainly be using a framework of giving you, say, 100 different sets of promises, and then figuring out which promises actually attract you more, and then giving those promises to 1 lakh more people, and so attract them more, and so on and so forth. There are going to be various types of big data stuff going to be offline, online, real time, and so on and so forth. And that is, you can see that being used not only in consumer marketing, not only in politics, but in every aspect of your life, including talking to your child. So for me, big data is very, very important from that perspective. And it has not been even scratched. People who market to you big data don't even understand what they are talking. You are going to actually see it rapidly evolving. I remember 8-10 years back, XBRL used to be hugely marketed. XML used to be hugely marketed. But people who came on stage didn't have a clue. They had a presentation from the head office. They kept on blabbering, and nobody figured. And every Tom, Dick and Harry, every school child, every engineer coming out of college knew about it, he implemented. All those guys who marketed and spent billions of dollars didn't get any money out of it. Why I'm telling you this is, it is going to happen. It may not get money to the companies which are marketing. And be aware, many of these things will happen. Other thing about, interesting thing about big data is that largely it will be non-SQL based. SQL can't handle the data we talk about. Largely it will be open source. Today, BSE's own database, data warehouse. I mean, we had 5 TB of data, and we are probably adding 5-10 TB every year or more. And we used to pay huge amount to a multinational. And one day, one of my ex-colleagues, who was on one of the committees of BSE, he said, can I do it on open source for you guys? I said, okay, if you can do it for free. And believe me, today I have 150 TB database at a fraction of cost of AMC of the previous 5 TB database. And the way the changes have happened, even organization has not even come to know that the technology behind has changed. My trading system used to be on a proprietary hardware, proprietary operating system. It used to have 5,000 orders per second capacity. It's very, very large. 5,000 orders a second is very large capacity. And it used to give me response time of 10 milliseconds. That is 1/100th of a second till 2014. But my competition had larger capacity and faster system. Every hardware used to cost me 25 crore, 5,000 orders a second, and 10 millisecond response time used to cost me 25 crore on production, 25 crore on backup, back office or DR site, and used to cost me 50 crore just to set that up. I had to go several times faster to beat the competition. Today, my speed is 200 microseconds. In 1 second, there are 10 lakh microseconds. I'm 50 times faster than my previous speed. And my capacity now is 5 lakh orders a second. It was 5,000 orders a second earlier, and now it is 5 lakh orders a second. And you know how much is the cost of hardware? Instead of 50 crore, for 5,000 orders a second and 10 milliseconds, now I am 50 times faster and 100 times bigger, 5,000 times. My cost has come down by 70%. I've gone open source. It's completely on Linux and MySQL. Why I'm telling you this is transparency framework and transformation framework come up in variety of ways in life. And you have to have that eyes and ears and also an ability to experiment to go about doing things. One of the most transformational things, especially for India, is going to be e-learning. e-learning for me is going to create Eklavyas whose thumbs will not be as bad thrown. In some sense, current people who are being educated in IITs, IIMs, engineering colleges, MBA colleges, everywhere, are basically people who are Arjuns. They are paying through their nose of their parents' money, and teachers are basically Dronacharya, who are taking huge money to train these people. But if you give a tablet or a mobile phone connected to internet to a young child who is on the street, who is a street urchin, he is going to be probably using it better than anything else. And one teacher can train billions of students. Current framework of teaching is going to change fundamentally. 10 years from now, for me, a Harvard, a Wharton, an IIT, an IIM, will have very little role to play except to get together and chat. Because if you want to learn, teaching is going to be different from learning. A student can learn at his own pace, at his own time. Today, I have to come and speak here, and all of you have to be also there at the same time. But once the speech is put on the net, you can actually look at it 100 times more. You can try to understand my English sometimes. Other people can read it or listen to it anytime they want, and so on and so forth. So teaching by one teacher can teach millions of students. A good teacher can reach out. Today it was not possible. And for me, education for youngsters of Eklavyas, not of Arjun. Arjuns always would pay up through the nose and get that education, which they have been doing for the last 5,000 years. It is the Eklavyas time which has come, and for me, that education, e-learning, is going to be completely different. And then it will change not where you come from, it is what you know. In fact, interestingly, I came across an article in Times of India's website, I think this Sunday, last Sunday. I was talking to former Chief Secretary of Australia. We were talking both. He is now the Chancellor of Western Australia University. And we were both chatting up on a breakfast, saying how life is going to, especially academic life, is going to change fundamentally. And then both of us say, it looks as if not what, it is not going to be about what degrees you have, but what you know. Same day, by afternoon, I got to see an interesting story in Times of India, that there was a professor who taught IT in one of the colleges in Andhra Pradesh, who projected himself to be a PhD from ISSC, but he was actually class 8 dropout. But he learned so much by reading on the net that he actually passed himself. He took somebody else's name and started becoming a professor, and he actually taught class for 2 or 3 years. And nobody could even figure out that he was a class 8 dropout. Why I'm telling you this is, it's supposed to be a crime that he took somebody's name and started teaching. But for me, all the degrees and all the diplomas and where you come from and all that sort of rigmarole of being somewhere nice or from somewhere nice is going to actually disappear. And where what you know and now is going to be more important than where you come from, right? So for me, education is going to be hugely disruptive. And if it does, then life is going to be hugely disruptive, because today the rich and poor, haves and have-nots, it's basically about information they have, about the knowledge they have, about the wisdom they have. In the same vein, what we were talking about last Sunday was basically about teaching a person a retail framework for 6 months and then putting him on the shop floor, or teaching him for two hours a framework. So, teaching him for 2 hours a framework, which is saying that you do point of sale on video. So, if you are going to do point of sale, why should you be taught about what is a supermarket, what is hypermarket, what is this, what is that, an entire theory of retailing? Instead, if you just tell him, in 1 hour, he can actually learn his job, go on to the shop floor straight away. So it's going to be hugely different. I can go on for a lot of time. I had probably prepared for 3-4 hours of speech, looks like, given the points I have. But 3D printing is going to change life fundamentally, look at it. Nanotechnology will change completely and thoroughly life. Robotics, is going to change wearable computers. Some of them are coming now, but they are all toys. 2-3 years time, you will have something completely different. Inside body computers, you will have a lot of computers falling, going inside your body, and they will measure temperature, pressure, everything else, sugar. If required, they will put some medicine also inside. Exoskeletons, a 50 kilo person will be able to raise 500 kilo stuff to make cars and so on and so forth. He will also be going into the war zone with all sorts of stuff so that he can run at 100 kilometers per hour without cars and stuff. So exoskeletons are going to be interesting stuff. Other things that are going to change life fundamentally is space technology. You will be able to move in outer space, in and out of space, pretty often like what you do in planes. Genetically modified agriculture is going to be life changing. Healthcare is going to change so fundamentally that in next 30-40 years, you will see people regularly living more than for 150 years. Synthetic life, you will be able to create life synthetically by adding more genes, by creating some here and putting them in. This guy called Craig Venter, I don't know if you have heard of him, but he's phenomenal. If you get chance, go to YouTube, listen to him. Growing of body parts, you are going to grow body parts. So you can grow liver, eyes, probably 4 hands and so on and so forth. Water is going to be another technology that's going to change life fundamentally. Agriculture, especially in India, is going to be vertical. That is, you will have multi-storied farms. Some of the more fundamental issues which I currently worry about is, if people live 150 years, what happens to morality? What happens to rich and poor? Will rich remain rich and poor will remain poor and they will never have a chance to come up? Will India have a civil war of people between 150 years and above and 20 years and below who are not actually able to come up in life because other guys are not vacating space? There are going to be many, many such moral issues, but I hope I gave you a glimpse of what is going to come, hopefully in our lifetime, probably suddenly in your children's lifetime. So thank you very much for listening to me.